Living Seed Media brings to you God's Word, which is His comprehensive equipment for changing lives. May the Lord impact your heart as you encounter His Word. For further inquiry or counsel, contact Peace House, P.O. Box 971, Boko, Benue State, Nigeria. Telephone numbers 0703-036-3659, 0703-768-1198. Email address lsmedia@livingseed.org or visit our website at www.livingseed.org. Let us sit back and listen as the servant of God brings forth the word of life.
This afternoon, we are deliberately going to study Ephesians 5 that we started reading. We are going to study it. You will permit us to study it, and then if we have issues of practical questions, just as we said before, we are going to open that up later on. So I want us to go back to Ephesians chapter 5. Sister Shade, you will help us again to read Ephesians 5. Today we are going to just take it off from verse 21 and go on until we get to verse 33. Ephesians chapter 5, 21 to 33.
Submitting to one another in the fear of God. Wives, submit your own husbands as to the Lord, for the husband is the head of the wife, as also Christ is the head of the church, and he is the Savior of the body. Therefore, just as the church is subject to Christ, so let the wives be to their own husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word, that he might present it to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. So husbands ought to love their own wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. For no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, just as the Lord does the church. For we are members of his body, of his flesh, and of his bones. For this reason a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This is a great mystery, but I speak concerning Christ and the church. Nevertheless, let each one of you in particular so love his own wife as himself, and let the wife see that she respects her husband.
Praise the Lord. Now, we have these several passages or verses ahead of us, and you will notice that the way the scripture unfolds before us, the Holy Spirit had put together some critical instructions both for the husband and for the wife. And so what we want to do this afternoon is go through it little by little. We discuss it, where Sister Shade will make an input, we'll try to do so, and we'll go ahead. When we take a chunk of time to get to as far as we can reach, if there are questions we can raise at that point. Praise the Lord. Now let me begin by drawing your attention to verse 21. You know, and that 21 flows from what we read, verse 18, 19, 20. I discovered that before we came to that verse 22, where it says, wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands as unto the Lord, I have noticed that there was an attitude that the Holy Spirit is raising for any matrimony to work well. It is the matter of mutual submission. You see, if we pick our study from verse 22 alone, we will be missing the basis on which God is setting out the Christian home. He said, submitting yourselves one to another. How? How? In the fear of God. So I want to note that why we'll be talking about wives submitting to your own husbands, which we are going to talk about deliberately now, let me note that the ground in which the whole thing works out is the ground of mutual submission. It says submitting yourselves one to another in the fear of God. Why husbands have specific roles that God is expecting him to play in the life of his wife, and the wife has been given a clear instruction of what to do, may we note that for the Christian home, it is not so stereotyped. It is not as if God is saying, well, whatever it is, you cannot consider what your wife has said. The Bible is saying, submitting yourselves one to another in the fear of God. To me, that is the word that must govern the rest of all our discussion. That if the two of us are eager to please God, if the two of us are eager to satisfy the Lord unto whom we have been called and who has called us to serve him, the first issue is that none of us is holding to his or her gun. Because what matters with God and with our marriages is not who wins the argument. Do you understand that now? It's not a question of who is winning the argument. What God is looking for is that there are no more two, but one flesh. So when we come into the presence of God, maybe we came to the altar and we want to offer the offerings and want to do all our officiating. What God is looking for is not whether at the end of the day you were able to subdue your wife. What God is looking for is that he looks inside and he finds that there is oneness. I don't know whether I'm sounding clearly. So that if you came to the altar and the Bible says, if you remember that someone has an ought against you, if that person is your wife, what is God saying you should do? Leave what you are doing, go and settle it. Now, if we have to leave what we are doing to go and settle with somebody that has an ought against you, what exactly does that imply? What does it imply? It means go quickly and agree. I'm confusing something there. It means then that God forbid that you should have a stubborn wife. I pray so. You didn't say amen. Some people didn't answer and they said, I already have one, so. Now, I really desire that you, we pray that you don't have a wife that is unbendable. But in God's ordinance, while we are trusting God to sanctify her, to bring her to a place where there will be no blemish, the first thing to still do while you are trusting that God will bring her to perfection is still to agree with her quickly. Submitting one to another in the fear of God. Now, if I'm the one to submit to my wife simply because I need to move on with God, we need to move on with God together. Number two, it is in reverence to God and to God's word. Even if she will have her way, just for us to maintain what? Oneness in the presence of God. It is more valuable in God's presence than to hold on to my gun and say, I'm sorry. Whether you like it or not, I am the husband of this house. Go and think about it. Whether you like it or not, you have already married me. And you bang the door, she's crying, she's weeping. You say, well, when you finish crying, you wipe, in fact, sometimes you give her the handkerchief. And say, you can wipe your tears. But when your eyes have opened, I'm still the husband. Go and do what I said to be done. Now, was God going to accept offering from such a hand? Eh? Now, so the question that is we are raising first is that as a background, what must be the pursuit of a couple is harmony and oneness, becoming one flesh. If we cannot achieve it, if we cannot achieve it from my own standpoint as, yes, you must do what I say. If we can achieve it by adjusting while you are holding God's hand, that God will bring perfection to both her understanding and your relationship, God still prefers unity in the home than a divided platform that everybody is claiming his or her own right. Hallelujah. Now, that is only possible. I want to quickly say, it's only possible when the old man had been brought to the cross and he was terminated. Praise the Lord. We are told that he was revived and he revived not again. We saw that the Lord Jesus, he made himself what? What did the Bible say he made himself? He made himself of no reputation. The Bible said he became poor that we might become rich. So we are noting that silently what makes a marriage to work is that and the woman, they have all come to the cross. Submitting one to another in the fear of God. Hallelujah. Now, having laid that as the general thing to pursue, please mark what I've said. while I am hoping that my wife will be growing in the grace of God to submit to her own husband in everything. Are you getting me? If she had not got that grace, God still will not agree with me to break the harmony while I'm insisting that until she learns the grace of what? Of submission. God is still saying, go back quickly and do what? And agree. Agree with her. Bring her up. So, I want to see if I'm making my point. I want to confirm that you are understanding that in our marital relationship, even when she's yet to perfect in submitting to her own husband, if I am growing well and if I am walking properly under the shadow of the cross, even her lack of submission is only but an opportunity for me to die more. Oh, I'm confusing you now. You are getting it. It were more advantageous that her lack of submission produces in me more character of Christ than for me to stagnate my growing into becoming like Jesus Christ on the excuse. You understand? That she is not obeying the Bible. Am I making it a bit complicated? What I'm saying is this. Let it not be that I'm losing my temper and that I am going about with anger and I'm going about with, you know, self-defense, which things are alien to the life that Christ has called me to live because the cross has taken place. And the reason why I will be doing that, I say, well, if not because I have a wife that does not submit to me, I will have been all right. But because of that, that's why I am not growing. God is saying, and this is the anchor that I'm beginning with tonight. I'm beginning with that because it is not right. I'm hearing maybe a wife say, should we submit to somebody who doesn't show love? May I say to you, your submission to him is your own way of growth. Hallelujah. And it does not depend on his own obedience to what God has told him to do to you. That may be a little difficult. Someone say, tell him. If he wants me to submit to him, he should also do what? He should love me first. It is not do make I do. You will see now as I'm reading that scripture out, you will see. It is not do make I do. Even though by the grace of God, the two of us, we are going to be working at our spiritual growth, even in our relationship. But may I say that the other's action But the other's inaction does not give you a basis not to act appropriately. Oh my God. Do you understand what I'm saying? I hope none of you are beating your wife. No answer. It's okay. You are being honest. Yes, it's all right. Now, but may I say to you, no matter what she does, it is not an excuse for you to misbehave by beating her. Have I made a point there? You say, what if she's the one who started beating me? What should I do? Nah. What should I do? You remember that somebody slapped him. Did he slap back? Eh? Aha. I have said two things here which I want you to bear in mind. That the home is the laboratory where the Christian experience is being worked out without hypocrisy. Amen? Number two, your personal growth and conformity to Christ, even as we are building our relationship in marriage, is more critical to God even than our enjoyment. So, may we note that as we go on today, as we will talk, my wife will begin to address the issue of wives. Submit yourself to your own husband as unto the Lord. She will be addressing that now. But I just want to note that why we say this, why we study, why we urge our wives to do what God is telling them to do, if they will grow well. May I say that if not, is that all right? If not, God's demand on my life is that despite that, I am becoming more and more like Jesus Christ. The husband that God is wanting me to be is the husband that mirrors Christ to his wife, no matter what she does or how she is. Praise the Lord. Do you understand this? Eh? Can I go on now? Let's go on. Now, we're now in verse 22. And I wish, if anybody carries, is there any Amplified Bible in our midst today? Is there by any means an Amplified Bible? Living Bible? There's a Living Bible there. But I'm looking for Amplified. No Amplified Bible among us today. Right? What do you have there? You have Living Bible? Praise the Lord. Right? Wives, that's verse 22. Submit yourselves to your own husbands as unto the Lord. Because, this is verse 23 now, the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, and he is the savior of the body. Therefore, as the church is subject to Christ, so let the wives be to their own husbands in everything. Would you like to highlight that for us at this point before we go ahead?
I discovered that looking at this scripture, the only thing that God asks the wife to do in the relationship between a man and his wife is to submit. That's the only thing. But But if you look at what God said the husband should do, it's such a great task. So, looking at that, it looks to me that the commandment of God actually, they are not grievous. He said, simply submit to your own husband. He said, wives, submit to your own husband as to the Lord. And from the Living Bible, he says, you wives must submit to your husband's leadership in the same way you submit to the Lord. It's like God is telling us that our husbands are God's representative in the home. That just as we submit to the Lord, we should submit to our husbands. Oftentimes, we make a lot of excuses. What if he is doing this? What if he is doing that? What if, I think, irrespective of what he does, it's like God is saying, I will hold him responsible. You do your own. I will hold him responsible. Do your own. But sometimes we think that God will not hold him responsible or is not fast in acting. So we want to act by ourselves. And so we lose on both ways. We are not able to do what God says. And because we do it by ourselves, you will discover that God will leave the matter in our hands and say, if you are able to handle him, let me see how far you can go. And so you discover that the issue is not resolved. Instead of it being resolved, actually the man grows tougher. Just because we are trying to use two wrongs to make a right, it doesn't work like that. He says, wives, submit to your own husband as you do to the Lord. And if we remember how we obey the Lord, it is without questioning. Secondly, from verse 23, God even went ahead to tell us the reason why we must submit to our husbands. That's God being gracious, because he doesn't even need to tell us. But in verse 23, he says, because the husband is the head of the wife, as also Christ is the head of the church, and he is the savior of the body. Why should we submit? God is saying, the husband is the head of the wife, just as Christ is the head of the body. And looking at this illustration of the body, the head and the body that God himself gave in this scripture, you will just discover that the head has every control over every part of the body. There is no part of the body, including the little toe, that has no control center in the brain, which is contained in the head. The head controls every part of the body, including the internal organs that we carry. The control center is located in the head. And if the body should refuse, let's say it happens that the body refuses to go according to the head, one of these days, it will enter into the ditch, because the head is saying, there is a ditch there. Don't put the leg inside. And he said, no way. Are you the only one that can see? I can also see. And then you go ahead. By the time you fall into the ditch and break your leg, even though it will affect the head also, but you have already put yourself into trouble and you have put the family into trouble. God simply says, the husband is the head of the wife. He carries all the special senses, because the head carries all the special senses for the body. The eyes, the ears, the nose, the taste, the mouth. All these are located in the head, not in the body. No matter how much spiritual a Christian woman is, and you can see very clearly, the fact remains that you cannot, the body cannot see as clearly as the eyes. I know that some blind people can still feel their way through, isn't it? They can still feel their way, but can you compare that with a clearly seeing eyes? No. It is an advantage for the body to submit to the sight of the head, because that's where it is located. Even if you say, oh, my own husband, he doesn't see clearly, the maker is still at work. He said, I will make. If he is not seeing clearly today, it doesn't mean the eyes are not located in the head. You can pray and God will do something so that your head can see clearly for you, rather than argue. The ear is in the head. All the special senses are located in the head. And these things are meant for the body to make use of. So if the body should refuse the administration of the head, it is ready to enter into trouble. So it's for our sake, it's for our good, that God is saying, look, this is how the manufacturer made it. This is how I made it. You are only the body. He is the head. Of course, the head also depends on the body. Is that not so? Both are mutually dependent. But this instruction is particularly for us wives. That what the head carries, you don't have it. Submit. Don't go about as if you are headless, doing things yourself alone, taking decisions by yourself alone, doing everything just the way you like alone, as if you are headless. And you know the identity of a body is also located where? In the head. If you see somebody whose head has been cut off, it's difficult to identify who owns that body.
Are you hearing so?
The identity of a woman is located in the husband.
Wow.
But if the wife decides to go headless, she is ready to run into a lot of confusion, because she will lose her identity. This thing doesn't depend on intelligence or education or whatever. You know, divorcees today, those who are divorced, even when they have PhD, they are not normal. There is something wrong somewhere. They have lost identity. They keep struggling to have identity and to argue. I can make it, yes, even though my husband is not there. Yes, I'm okay. Why are they arguing? It's because the identity is lost. It is for our sake, it's for our good that God says, look, I have located all that you need in terms of special senses, in terms of control inside your head. Submit. It's to our advantage. And secondly, it is for our good shepherding. Because when the eyes sees for you, it's capable of, shepherding you the right way, so that you don't miss it even at the end.
So a woman's submitting to her husband actually is the is advantageous.
It is. Because it is God himself that used this illustration. That's why I felt we need to look at it, even biologically, physiologically. Let's look at it. That this head has these special functions that God wants it to perform for the body.
So a wife must pray that her head will be correct.
Some people have heads that are not correct. Some people's heads are not correct.
Wow.
That is the truth. There are some that have heads that are not correct. But it is still the head. So the best thing to pray for is that God will make your own head correct.
My God. This is serious. And to try to cut him off is to cut off your head.
And you yourself, you won't survive.
And then you become headless. Now, wives, are you hearing this? Eh? Now, before we go on, I wanted to read from an Amplified Bible, so I went to look for where I could get it. Now, know that while we are reading Ephesians chapter 5, verse 22, if you go to 1 Peter chapter 3, 1 Peter chapter 3, let's quickly go to 1 Peter 3. I just want to raise one or two issues before we let Esther Shade off from the issue she's dealing with about submission. Wives submitting to your own husband as an advantage. It is not punishment. That's what I'm hearing you say. Eh? It's not punishment, and it is not subjugation. It's not oppression. So when a woman submits to her husband, she's not being oppressed. She's only receiving correct shepherding, correct direction, and safety. May the Lord convince our wives to see it that way. Maybe that's the beginning of it. If a woman thinks that, why should I submit to him? Is he the only one that knows? That may be where the agitation comes from. And of course, if death has occurred, if the cross has dealt with that ego that is saying, is he the only one that knows? You will see that marriage becomes the easiest thing for you by the grace of God. Now, let's read 1 Peter chapter 3. Are you in 1 Peter chapter 3? All right. Now, the King James Version put it like this. Likewise, ye wives, be in subjection to your own husbands, that if any obey not the word, they also may, even without the word, be won by the conversation of the wives. While they behold your chaste conversation coupled with fear. But when we take it now from Amplified Bible, I read it. It says, in like manner, you married women, be submissive to your own husbands. And the word submissive in Amplified has been put like, subordinate yourselves as being secondary to and dependent on them. Adapt yourselves to them so that even if any of them do not obey the word of God, they may be won over not by discussion but by the godly lives of their wives. When they observe the pure and modest way in which you conduct yourselves, together with your reverence for your husband, you are to feel for him all that reverence includes, to respect, defer to, revere him, to honor, esteem, appreciate, prize, and in the human sense, to adore him, that is, to admire, praise, be devoted to, deeply love, and enjoy your husband. Now, I just want to read this to talk about what essentially is submission. What does submission actually entail? What does it mean? What is submission? Now, from what we are reading here, submission of a woman to her husband is not always. Actually, I don't think submission is very strong when your husband is actually doing what you actually want him to do. Eh? Is there any big deal in submitting to something that you are really wanting him to do? Eh? Talk to me, sir. Moms, are you hearing me? you want your husband to go to Boko. You want him to carry you to Boko. And he stood up in the morning and said, I think I should take you to Boko. Let's go to Boko. If you jump into the car and you follow him to Boko, are you submitting to him? Eh? It's already your will. So you know the matter of submission actually only begins when you are submitting your will to him, when your will actually is not his will. Oh my God, am I confusing you now? I hear many wives that they think that submission is only when we have discussed and he has agreed to do what you want him to do, that's when you are meeting. But submission actually, in the real sense of it, is that act of handing over your own opinion, your own will, your own convenience, when his own is totally different. When you will have said, well, if that's what you want, I don't want that. That's only when submission becomes honestly meaningful. I would not see a wife who wanted to eat bush meat. Eh? And the wife, I mean the husband, went and got bush meat and say, I just felt like going to bring bush meat. Should I bring it? And she said, that's what I want now. Is that submission? Eh? But supposing the woman wanted to eat bush meat, and the man is saying, it is fish. I feel that I should go and bring. And this fish is a ice fish. And the woman joyfully adapts her taste and say, if that is what you feel we should eat, it's okay. And she does it joyfully. What has she done? That's submission. Am I confusing a matter there?
Excuse me, sir. I want to look at where we stopped yesterday, which was a great blessing, you know, that Christians, one another, we are polite, we are nice to each other, and all of that. Now, the wife comes and says, I'm going to see my uncle in our village tomorrow. And I said, So you are going? She said, I'm going. Are you asking for permission or you are informing me? Are you with me? Now, I think that aspect of submission, we must grow from information center to submission center.
You didn't catch that last point, sir.
I said, so from information center, where the wife will say, we just pass information of what she's going to do.
Uh-huh.
Now, whether you say yes or you say no, she's still going to do it. After all, she has told you. And then graduate to submission center.
Did you get that? That many times, what women do, sometimes a wife, just comes from the information center. Just to tell the husband, I'm going to my uncle tomorrow. And the husband is saying, are you informing me or you are asking whether you can go? They were, I've already told you, I'm going there tomorrow. Is that submission? What is that? That's information. So now, thank you very much for highlighting the fact that part of submission, now which I want to now, I want to read it from here. I said, be submissive to your own husband, which means subordinate yourselves as being secondary to. Subordinate yourself. Now, I love the way the word of God is coming. If it is the husband that subordinate his wife, what is that? That is oppression. So wives, don't wait to be oppressed. It is not your dignity that he has to raise his voice to shout you down. You are not to be oppressed. Submission is a willing submission. It's a willing, It's a willing. Put it together
for the dictionary. I was trying to tell the dictionary meaning. It says it is obedience to another person's will.
Submission is a voluntary, willing obedience to another person's will. Even when it is not in the line of your own will. Now, I'm highlighting that because my wife said something. She said, of all the instructions that God gives the husband, which is very much, very elaborate and many much serious than this, the only thing that God says to the wife, just one thing, and if the woman will do it, she will live long, she will enjoy her marriage, God will honor her, God will fight for her, and it is only one thing. What is that one thing? Submit. To submit means to subordinate yourself. Don't let somebody subordinate you. But you yourself, you are the one who voluntarily subordinate yourself. You make yourself a subordinate to him as being secondary to him. Accept in your mind that, look, I am the second to him. I am not first. I am not primary. I am secondary to him. And I am dependent on him. I am dependent on his judgment. I am dependent on his vision. I'm dependent on his wisdom. It's not that I'm not wise, but I've decided to submit, to subordinate my wisdom to his wisdom. I don't know why you understand that now. A woman is very intelligent. You can even be more intelligent than your husband on some certain issues. But what the Holy Spirit is saying is that subordinate, make that great intelligence that you have, make it what? Secondary to him. Let it become supportive. Let it become a subordinate. Even though there's so much you will have wanted to do because you are very intelligent, you are well trained. But as a wife, God is saying, by yourself, don't let it be him who rubbish your intelligence. Do you understand now? Don't let it be him who makes your intelligence useless. This is where the critical issue of submission between husband and wife comes from. Do you know that when you subordinate yourself, your intelligence, your wisdom, your suggestion to him, he cannot trample on it? You see, men tramples on your intelligence, on your wisdom, when they think you are using it to rule them. Wives, are we talking together? So, that scripture now says, thank you, ma'am. It now says, adapt yourselves to them. I want somebody to please speak about the word adapt. What does it mean to adapt? What's the meaning of adapt? Eh? To fit in. Be flexible. Don't be rigid. Don't insist and say it must be this. If it was this before, and in building your relationship with your husband, drop that rigidity and do what? Fit into his plans. Adapt yourself to him. Adapt. Will anybody want to speak more about the word adapt or what this means? Because we're digging into a matter here that if God will help us to just follow Bible, there will be little or no friction in our relationship anymore. Praise the Lord. Any question about this matter of adapt? Submit yourself to him. Then we are going to take the next aspect of submission. Yes, brother, but you are not a woman or a question. Can you keep your question until we have arrived where we are going? I just wanted any input into the understanding of the word adapt. Adapt yourselves to them. Yeah? Yes, sir. There's a hand here. Yes? I'm surprised that it's only men that want to talk about this adapt. I thought women would have understood it better.
I think the issue of adaptation, using this common illustration, I came from Warri, where the weather has been very hot even throughout the night. I come to Boko, the weather has been cold. I have to make sure that in order for me to be able to stay throughout the period of the conference, maybe I get some sweater, put on stockings. Maybe I'm not even used to rubbing Vaseline pomade. In order for my body to be fresh, I have to go and get some Vaseline pomade. But all these materials that I'm gathering is in order to enable me
to adapt,
okay, to the weather here in Boko.
All right.
I think that is what the Bible is trying to tell the women.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, sir.
All right. Thank you. Now, but don't forget that verse 21, that was the basis of where we're coming, said, submitting one to another in the fear of God. Eh? So, if it became difficult for the wife to adapt, and yet God is demanding for harmony, oneness in the marriage, who is going to adapt now? Okay. Do you understand what I'm saying? Now, one lady there now. Yes, a lady. Yes.
When we talk about adaptation, I'm looking at it from the gadget, the electrical gadget that we call adapter in the home. Like we have 110 current, maybe an equipment that is using 110, but in Nigeria we use 220. Now to use that equipment, you will need an adapter.
Yes.
Something that will convert the 220 current to 110. Now if there is no harmonization of the current, you will blow up the equipment. Two, when we have differences, if we don't adapt, put an adaptation, which may be the word of God, of course, which should be the word of God, and then we try to harmonize the current to avoid blowing up the marriage. For example, maybe the praying life, the way you like to pray or study the Bible or use your tongue is different from the way the husband wants to do his own. So to adapt, it means the kind of the the way you do it, you have to harmonize it. Maybe cut it down as 220 will be cut.
The 120.
Or you increase it as 110 if it's the other country now where you are using it. So you just put the stabilizer and the adapter. If there will be a blow up.
Wow. Thank you. Praise the Lord. So what we are saying is this. Don't be rigid. Seek to fit in. Is that all right? Even if you are going to adjust, to make sure you fit into your husband. And do it not because he's the one squeezing you inside. Let it be you who is voluntarily adapting. That is the glory of submission. If you wait until he is the one who does it for you, then it becomes oppression and you make your husband cruel. Let me explain this last bit before I go away. You see, if a husband had to shout before his wife submits to him or agrees with him, two things had happened to that man. Number one, he has lost a measure of grace. Are you getting me? Number two, inside him, it is registered that you are not a husband, you are a tyrant. So, and that is what makes him much more aggressive. I don't know whether many wives you have understood that sometimes, even when your husband forces his way to get something done that you did not agree, do you know that even when you have now done it, he is still not happy? Have you noticed that? You have noticed that he will still be feeling, you know, you say, but I have done it. The reason is because that thing that you have allowed him to do has led to indelible damage on his personality. The first thing is that it is clear to him that he is not a leader. A leader that begs for followership is not a leader. And that's why you will hear him say, "You don't respect me." Have you been hearing your husband always saying, "You don't respect me"? Eh? And the wife say, "How? How have I not respected you?" That's the point he's raising. If he had to argue his way before he gets you to follow him, he doesn't feel respected. He feels he's a tyrant. When it comes even to relationship, conjugal relationship between husband and wife, you know there are times that your husband comes in and says he wants something now, now, now. When you give all the explanation, you know, "I'm tired, I'm this, I'm that, and that." It's okay, when? Anyway, I don't know when I will be, I'll be all right. Even when he had to force his way through, and you say, "Well, since, what can I do? Can I overpower you? Just do anything." You know that even though he has done it, the sister still come back to thank him. He still feels oppressed. You have made him a tyrant. And that affects his psychology more than anything else. So, wives, when we talk about submitting, it must be voluntary. It must be initiated from your side. That's the glory of it. It's not as if some men cannot have their way if they are ruling. And you know, some husbands, they have come to that level where they don't even look at your face. They just say, "We are going now. Obey before complain." Now, when a man has to do that, he's not doing well. He himself knows that he's not doing well. And when he stands even to preach, something inside of him say, you are not a leader. If not because you force your way through, she will not have followed you here. Praise the Lord. Now, someone will say, but if he is not himself obeying the word of God, look at the way the Bible says, even so, that if any do not obey the word of God, they may be won over, not by discussion, but by the godly lives of their wives. Many wives think that they can win their husband over by discussion, by argument. But I want to say, according to scriptures, that even husbands that do not obey the word of God, they will be won over, not by discussion, but by the godly lives of their wives. When they observe the pure and modest way in which you conduct yourself together with your reverence for your husband, you are to feel for him all that reverence includes. What are the things that reverence includes? According to Amplified Bible, it means to respect. Now, you know, I'm bringing all of this because when we are reading, if we understand the content of the word submit, and God helps you as a mother here, as a wife here, and you catch that genuinely, and you do it with eagerness, maybe half of all the challenges we are going to be facing your husband with will be resolved, because God will deal with him by himself. To respect, to defer to him. What will he mean to defer to? Let him have the last say. To defer to him. You have something to say, you have something you think should have been done, but because he has a different view, we defer to him. We defer to his view. We let his view carry the day. And we do it not because he forced his view on ground, but that you willingly defer to him. And you revere him to honor, esteem, appreciate, prize. And in the human sense, to adore him, that is, to admire, to praise, to be devoted to deeply love and enjoy your husband. This is the word of the Lord. Hallelujah. Right. Now, can we move now and read the next point so that we are not building on one side tonight? Can we see what God says to the husband? Eh? Now, my wife had helped us to look at that verse 23, and she has started explaining that the husband is the head of the wife. You know, that scripture to me is very, very sharp. For the husband is the head of the wife. Even as Christ is the head of the church, and he is the savior of the body. Now, I'd like us to spend just a bit of time to discuss what that will mean. Now, let's look at it together. It said, for the husband is the head of the wife. Now, I don't want to take it again from the angle which she has taken it. The fact that the head carries the identity, carries all the sensory organs, carries the nerve center that controls every other part of the body. I feel that what she has said about that is sufficient. And as a husband, now I want you to see that Your wife is unfortunate if you are a wrong head.